Wow, deep frozen engine. Hello there. This video was actually originally going to be a bit different than I planned. I actually planned to make a Joseph only video, basically the history of these things, but I haven't had time to actually gather all the information. It seems like basically the first idea doesn't really work out that well, but since we have this, which is Mr. Anspantz's machine, and behind the camera is the Kirovets, I'm going to just do two-in-one video. We're not going to do a detailed one, but we're going to just do a simple bias guide, because I'm sure that some people are itching to get their hands on one of these old machines or these big bulldozers or big tractors. But there's a few things I want to mention, just because there's a lot of people that just don't know about it. So just a reminder what you're going to be in for when you're buying these machines. So without wasting too much time, let's get to the basics. As you can see, we have both machines. We have on the right side, we have the Kirovets K700A, or the Belarus 7000 series for those in Canada, North America. And we have the Joseph T170, which is just, I don't know if they even export those into North America, but probably not. Because, you know, who wants a cat clone when you have a lot of caterpillars for sale, right? Right. So let's get to the basics. First of all, the Kirovets K700A. Now, this guy here is, as you can see from the videos I'm going to link into this video, into the description, this thing wasn't in working order. And when you're going to buy this tractor, the first thing I would say is make sure it has decent tires, because these are also old, and you know, they're old but they're not cracked. But usually when they're horribly cracked, these tires are not cheap at all. The second thing you want to look is the engine. You want to make sure that this engine doesn't have coolant and water or just oils mixed up, because if those are, you know, mixed up, you're looking at then really expensive engine rebuild. The second thing is the hydraulics. Now, I'm going to link Anspantz's video how he fixed the hydraulics. This thing was badly leaking and it had almost no hydraulic fluid left. So because it has a hydrostatic transmission, you do want to make sure that the gears work. The gear shifter, you know, where is just something you can expect. But the most important thing is make sure that the gearbox isn't fuel barred. The fourth rear item is these cylinder pins and these pins where the pivot shaft goes that turns the rear side of the tractor. Those are a typical wear item. Leaks in general are just what you can expect from an old machine like this. Brakes, probably if they're not functioning, then, or they're just too horrible, well, you're gonna have to take all these wheels off. So you better be prepared to just have a loader or some, if you let it do in a shop, then they'll charge you pretty much a good amount of money for it. So basically what you want to do when you're buying this thing is these four things. Number one, the engine health. Number two, transmission health. Number three, the bushing and pin wear on the rear axle. That's important. And number four would be just all the general items as well. I mean, basically, if the tractor is incomplete, it's already a bad start, because finding donor parts or donor tractors is pretty much impossible these days. And if it works, it's great. If it has not worked for a long time, you should pretty much just be prepared for pretty much anything. And as you can see, it's a big machine, so you definitely need a company to haul it. Same goes for the Joseph tractor. Both of these are really heavy machines. So yeah, pretty much I would say if you want to buy a Kirovets, just be prepared that one thing is if you can get it for a low price, the second price will you pay for all the repairs that have, you know, if the machine has been kept well, then you don't have to worry about it. But if it's an old neglected machine, well, then it's just going to be wallet rip anyways. So basically, this was a bit for the Kirovets. Now let's move on to the Joseph tractor. And we get to the Joseph tractors. Now, first and foremost, before you even consider, you know, the engine's health, make sure you watch the pin and pushing wear. And when I say pin and pushing wear, I mean these guys over here. You want to put your hand in and see if the pins are worn, if they have been turned. Now, Ann Spencer's one has been turned, so he doesn't have to worry about it. Basically, the setup is the same as on a Cat D6, D8. So you want to see that the track rollers are not worn in. There's not some funky wear going on with bottom rollers or top rollers. Sprockets you want to, you know, definitely keep a lookout for. And even if the machine is running order and it's, you know, looking nice, but the entire track or the undercarriage side is just gone or too worn. It's basically a parts machine. I'm just sorry to burst the bubble. And this isn't even me saying this. I've seen also a lot of Caterpillars that have the same problem. The tracks are just so horribly worn. I'll probably link a few videos here that you can go and watch and see how much work does it take to do these track pin turning and bushings. Basically turning the tracks, renewing them, versus also really worn ones. So I would recommend going to those, and if anyone is selling a machine like this and the tracks and everything else in the undercarriage is just too far gone, I don't know if there's any point of buying it anyway, because you can't even find, unlike Caterpillars where you can find like some replacements, not even for the older models anymore, you can't find anything to this guy. So basically, even if you can find it, it's going to be at least twice as much as the machine's own value. So if the undercarriage is gone, that's a no-goer. Now let's move on to the second thing, which is important on these Joseph tractors. The second thing, obviously, is the engine part. Now, this engine that Mr. Anspans has is relatively good. This one's been well kept, it's been well maintained. Well, there was a few hiccups here and there, but mostly the engine runs fine. And if it's a tractor that's been sitting with an open stack, then you can expect pretty much that engine to be ruined, because once the water and moisture mix in and it's been, you know, like this for decades or years, it's not going to be a pleasant one. The engine rebuild is also really expensive. I mean, the expensive part is probably not the rebuild itself, but finding the parts, and there's only really few companies that can do it. The parts on this T170 are not interchangeable with Caterpillar. This is a completely different tractor, despite it's a Cat knockoff, but it's a completely different machine. So you're going to be looking at some really, really bad things. The engine wear, I mean, you can actually get an engine that is, you know, less worn or really, really in a good shape. So the engine would be the second problem. If the engine's bad, well, you're looking at an expense, but it's still less than fixing a broken undercarriage. That I will say. Now, you definitely want to see if the engine isn't stuck. You definitely want to make sure that the fluids stay in, that there's no funky milkshake going on in the oil department. You definitely would also, with a lot of rollers, you want to see if they have been greased, if there's any oil in it. Definitely the rear axle is also the third important one. There's like both side steering clutches. If they're frozen up or they don't move at all, you're pretty much looking not looking at extra work, because you have to take off the tracks, the sprockets, and because these have also master pins, they're not going to come loose at all. Drawbar wear, let me show you. This is very typical that you can expect from these machines. Drawbars usually are very worn on this. Rarely you see a non-worn drawbar on these Joseph tractors. They are all bad, so, but they're repairable, and it does take a lot of time to wear them completely out, but drawbar is probably replaceable, but it's still, you need a parts tractor, because I don't think, I'm not even sure if you can get this part even new. So that is definitely something to look up for. Steering clutches can be repaired, but like I said, if they're completely frozen over or they're completely seized, then you're looking at some really bad expenses, because you're gonna have to hire manpower, because you need a lift, a forklift or skid steer to take the steering clutches out. The cabin needs to come off, and basically, even if you can get those discs free, you still have to rivet them, and it's a lot of work. It's not really expensive, but it's a lot of man hours, labor, intensive grind, basically. So yeah, if the steering clutches are frozen up, it's not a huge catastrophe, but you're looking at just a lot of work on your own. So let's get me to the other point on this Joseph tractors. The other point of the Joseph tractors is this pony engine. Now the pony engine is a separate thing. Finding parts to this guys is not anymore that it, you can find parts, but they definitely takes a lot of effort to even, you know, get one running one. A lot of people converted to the starters. I'm not a fan of stars. I'm a pony engine believer. These ones, they take a lot of beating before they give up the ghost. But definitely, if your engine is running low on oil or it's just eating too much oil, then there's something going on. Usually stuck rings, but it can be a determination of something else. So this is probably one of the rare items you want to make sure stays healthy by just, you know, taking regular maintenance, and also all these compartments as well, where there's oil and you just need to make sure that everything is oiled and well, which happens with a lot of machines that sit. Usually that pony engine clutch gets stuck or the main clutch is stuck. So I'm probably sure that those people that have watched Anspans' channel know that he had problems with the stuck clutch, and that thing was really stuck. Like, I'm not gonna lie. That's something you can keep up for. Rust on these cabins, as on the Kirovets, really common, but not as severe unless it's worked in a salt mine or something. So, hydraulic cylinders, if they're leaking, well, it's not hard to replace the seals inside, but if these hydraulics cylinder stems are gone, or they're just pitted, then well, that's an expense you can be looking forward to. It just pretty much rip your wallet at that point. Grousers, on the other hand, well, they can be rebuilded and rebuilt up. These are not that much of a problem, but it's also another expense. So in general hindsight, if you want the Joseph tractor, just be aware that there's going to be a lot of maintenance that you have to do on your own. Even if the machine is in running and good order, it doesn't have any of the problems I mentioned before. Just take it this way. Joseph and Kirovets are actually for the true diehard enthusiasts, in my opinion. It's, even if you have a lot of money to spend, you don't have, actually there's not much use for these old machines anymore. Kirovets are probably obsolete and extinct. The last time I saw them being used into traffic was, I'm pretty sure, 10 years ago or something, when they used to plow the roads. But right now, they're just completely obsolete. Joseph tractors are just going extinct, because pretty much these models, these T170s, don't have exactly a collectible value. The ones that people want as a collectible tractor are the S65, S60, S80, S100, T100M. Those are really sought after collectible Joseph tractors. Kirovets, not that much. These T-130 and 170, they're starting to become collectibles, but it still takes a lot of time because there's still some around. But I would say the number of these tractors is dwindling, and the older the model, the less there are them around. Even you can't find parts tractors anymore. It isn't like, you know, with the John Deere or Caterpillar, which is from the 70s. You can go into a salvage yard and find parts for them. With these ones here, you kind of have to get, you have to salvage every piece if you can find it. And sometimes, you know, one thing is having a lot of money, but having good friendships and, you know, knowing other collectors is actually the way to go with these. I've learned over the years, because that actually helps you to network with other people that have these parts. And it's pretty much just like I said, this hobby, for a hobby machine, it's an awesome thing. But if you want something for like to just work 24/7, you are better off buying a JCB or a Caterpillar. But for just something that is cool, I would recommend it. But like I said, there's a lot of, you know, pitfalls with these, both of these, that you can end up with. So maybe this video isn't the most detailed one, but I just gave you a basic overview of what you can expect from these machines. And at, you know, at this point, we're making this video 2025, most of them are likely high hour machines, unless if they've been in one, you know, one person's property for all of their life. But pretty much that's what you can expect. And I really hope this video found future Joseph and Kirovets buyers helpful. I mean, it's pretty much the sum what I know and what I've been working with. So hope this video found you all useful, and make sure to watch all the videos down in the description, because they are also provide more insight information from what I already told. So I hope you enjoyed it, and see you around all in the next videos.